Good evening and a warm welcome to the second day of the national webinar by industry experts organized by the departments of biochemistry, microbiology and PG departments of applied microbiology, bioinformatics and clinical trial management, Dr. M.G. Janaki College for Women. Yesterday we had an informative presentation by Dr. Venkata Subbulakshmi, founder and managing director, Darthi Healthcare Technologies Private Limited, Bangalore, who listed the career options for the students of various science fields. A hearty welcome to the speaker of the day, Dr. Ramanathan Vairamani, Chief Technology and Innovation, Rallies India Limited, who will enlighten us on the effect of genetically engineered crops on health. We express our sincere thanks to our correspondent, Dr. Lata Rajendran, Chairman Mr. Kumar Rajendran, for supporting us in all our endeavors. I now request Dr. Vijay Lakshmi, Assistant Professor, Department of Biochemistry, to introduce the speaker.
A very good evening to one and all. I have great pleasure in introducing the speaker of the day, Dr. Ramanathan Vairamani, Chief Technology and Innovation, Rallis India Limited, Seed Division. Dr. Ramanathan has obtained his doctoral degree in plant biotechnology from Madurai Kamaraj University in 1995. He unraveled the mechanism of tDNA transfer from agrobacterium to plants using recombinant DNA technology, plant transformation, and southern hybridization. He is a pragmatic leader with more than 20 years of experience in the Indian agriculture industry and strong technical background in the areas of plant genomics, biotech trait development, and crop breeding programs. He has served as a visiting scientist for 2 years in Weizmann Institute of Science, Rehovot, Israel, and developed a ligation-free primer in situ extension sequencing technology to help automate the human genome sequencing project as part of a team. He has been a postdoctoral fellow for a period of 3 years in Cornell University, where he developed agrobacterium-mediated rice transformation system and generated events for an insect control trait. He has served as research biologist from 1999 to 2001 in Monsanto India Limited, where he led the transformation team in rice functional genomics group, which generated thousands of events across many candidate events. One lead became commercial in the USA as drought tolerant maize. He has collaborated with the vector construction team in the US and provided a solution for retrofitting BAC clones into binary vectors, for which he received the Outstanding Performer Award for R&D in India in 2000. He has led the genomics team in Metahelix Life Science from 2001 to 2008 and has set up biotech programs in rice, maize and cotton and enabled deregulation of an elite event in cotton in India. He also ran functional genomics discovery projects using the rice system to validate genes from multiple crop species. He has been a Rice Research Director Asia in Pioneer Overseas Corporation India and has built an Asia-wide program for hybrid rice product development and strengthened using molecular breeding technologies. Currently, he is working as a Chief Technology and Innovation, Rallis India Limited, Seeds Division. He is involved in developing R&D strategy and establishing collaborations of complementarity. He has greater expertise in driving innovation and development of IP portfolio. He is an expert in DNA cloning, RNA extraction, transgenic plant technologies, nucleic acid hybridization, protein expression, and plant pathogen diagnostics. To his credits, he has many publications in reputed journals. We are indeed very happy to have such an eminent person with us today. Sir, we are very much eager to listen to you. Before handing over the session to Sir, there are a few instructions to the participants. Kindly mention your name and institution in the chat box, post relevant questions, and do fill the attendance and feedback form posted towards the end of the session for certificate purpose. I welcome and hand over the session to Dr. Ramanathan, sir. Sir, over to you.
Good evening. Good evening, one and all, for joining me in this session on a Saturday evening, because typically Saturdays are meant to be breaks. But I'm very glad that we have joined together in this learning session during a weekend. And so I'll skip the title part since that has already been mentioned. And I would like to very briefly lay out the topics that I will be covering in this 45 to 50 minutes session. I would very briefly cover what is genetic engineering, which is also called as genetic modification. What are the methods using which these are achieved. And then a few examples of GM crops and how exactly they are globally distributed, what kinds of crops are grown in what kinds of countries and so on. And then I will move to the crux of this program, which is effects of the GM crops. I will actually try to compare the benefits as well as the concerns or risks of the GM crops. And I will move on to a more pivotal issue of why GM is required, and also would cover the regulatory framework which ensures that whichever GM crop is released into the environment meets all the safety requirements. So this slide basically gives you a comparison. On the left-hand side, if you, let me just bring up the pointer. See, this is actually a maize cob as we are seeing today. But several thousand years back, the small red circle you see here, that is how actually a maize cob looked. And that is enlarged many times in this left-hand red circle with a coin comparison to show how it looked so many thousands of years back. And just by careful selection and directing the evolution of the crop through human hands, something like this has been achieved. And similarly, what you see on the right-hand side is called as wild mustard. It's a Brassica species. This Brassica oleracea actually has been used as the progenitor to breed multiple crops. Actually, you will be really surprised to see crops like cauliflower, cabbage, broccoli, Brussels sprouts, kohlrabi. All of these have been developed from this progenitor. That is how human intervention has been actually modifying the genetics of crops from ages. So genetic modification in its true sense is not new to the mankind at all. And the next slide highlights the salient differences between the classical version of breeding versus the modern version of breeding. Classical breeding basically involves crossing of a donor variety, which is shown as orange genome here, with a recipient variety, which is shown with the green DNA. And you can see there is a red portion shown here, which is the desired gene. So that is the only part we want to be transferred from the donor into the recipient. And through conventional breeding, when we try to do something like this, typically what happens is there is a lot more of the flanking part from the donor that moves into the resultant new variety, not just around the locus that we are focusing on, but also in other regions of the genome. Now, when we move to modern breeding, you can actually call modern breeding as either genetic engineering or marker-assisted breeding. So both of them would be called as modern breeding. And what we are actually trying to do is, if this is the desired gene and we want to specifically move only this part, either using marker-assisted breeding or using transgenesis, we will be able to specifically incorporate only that into the new variety. And now it is not a classical or modern. Breeders have found ways by which there can be a happy handshake between the old and the new. So the key question here, so it's an objective driven path. So is the trait of interest present in a close relative? What does it mean? See, let us say Oryza sativa is rice. And there can be a close relative of Oryza sativa called Oryza longistaminata. And if longistaminata has a resistance trait, then there are ways by which it can be moved into new varieties using conventional methods as well as marker-assisted breeding. But if the answer to this question is no, then the only option left to us is to bring the genes from other organisms which cannot be sexually crossed to the organism in which we are interested in improving. See, for instance, we are interested in developing a bollworm resistant cotton. If you scan all cotton varieties as well as the relatives of cotton, you don't see a trait like resistance to bollworms in any of those. Then what do? We bring in a bacterial gene which can confer that kind of resistance, and we get into GMO breeding to specifically develop cotton which is improved for its resistance to bollworms. And moving on to the methods for genetic engineering or genetic modification, I'm not actually covering exhaustively. This is just to give you a general idea of the major ones that are available out there. And a lot of you would have heard about all of these. There is a lot of people use Agrobacterium tumefaciens, and they have their own justifications as to why Agrobacterium tumefaciens is used. And my own justification is because actually I worked on this bacterium for my PhD. I would say actually, if you want to get low copy integrations of transgenes in a crop of your interest, then go for Agrobacterium. Because when you actually use a gene gun or biolistics, you are bombarding a plant cell with actually millions of molecules of the DNA that is carrying the gene that you want to insert into the plant of interest. And that leads to actually multiple copies getting integrated into the plant genome and resolving it to get something that is clean from a transgenic regulation perspective is going to be a challenge. And of course, the emerging kid on the block is gene editing, and I will touch a little bit on that. Now, using all of these, actually, what are the genetic differences we are trying to make is what I have listed under applications. First one is overexpression. For example, again, I'll go back to the cotton and BT or Bacillus thuringiensis crystal protein example. So if you want to introduce the bollworm resistance in cotton, you will introduce the BT gene from Bacillus thuringiensis into cotton in such a way that it is overexpressed to ensure that this safe protein is expressed intrinsically in plant tissues and offers protection when there is attack by the bollworms. The second is silencing. There are various applications where silencing is useful, and I will also touch upon one such example in one of the subsequent slides, and that example happens to be the very first example of a GM crop, which is tomato, called Flavor Saver. And the third one is a functional modification or a mutation where the gene is neither overexpressed nor silenced, but it is functionally modified to do something different. Moving on to Agrobacterium tumefaciens mediated transformation, what you see on the left-hand side is Agrobacterium, and what you see on the right-hand side is the plant cell. You can see the cell wall here, which is loaded with a lot of cellulose. What happens is this break here in the cell wall is a representation of a wound or an injury on a plant cell. And when there is an injury, there are some metabolic process happening in the plant cell for initiating repair. And that metabolism actually releases some phenolic compounds as well as sugars, which are used by Agrobacterium as the sensors of a wounded plant cell. So these actually act as both attractants and stimulators of tDNA transfer from Agrobacterium. So once these are seen, Agrobacterium gets attached to the plant cell, number one, and then the phenolics and sugars through a signal transduction system through these dual genes of VIR-A and VIR-G. VIR stands for virulence. VIR-A is actually the sensor, and VIR-G is the transducer, which is actually a transcriptional enhancer for a set of VIR genes that are present on the TA plasmid. And the expression of those VIR genes is required for processing this tDNA to release a single-stranded form of the tDNA, which is then coated by the protein VIR-D1 as well as VIR-E2, which is a single-strand DNA binding protein. And some of the other VIR genes form actually a channel between the bacterium and the plant cell, and the nucleoprotein complex is channeled through this bridge into the plant cell. And because proteins like VIR-D2 as well as VIR-E2 have what are called as nuclear localization signals, this nucleoprotein complex gets transported into the plant nucleus. And that is where actually it gets integrated at a random position in the plant genome. And then actually once it gets into the nucleus, the plant's own repair processes ensure it gets randomly integrated into the plant genome. This is how agrobacterium mediated transformation is achieved. The second one is a physical method called biolistics. This equipment that you see on the left hand side is actually the biolistics machine. Alternatively, there are also other handheld gun-like equipments which also do the biolistics. But the principle is simple. So this is the chamber, okay? And this is how the chamber is prepared. There is actually a plastic piece that is coated with gold particles carrying the target DNA. And what you then do is actually you pass helium gas at high pressure through this chamber. And once it actually comes through at such force, it breaks the plastic disc that is sitting here, and the plastic pieces that have been shattered act as projectiles and then hit this part, which is carrying the gold particles that are coated with DNA. And there is a filter, which is called as the screen, which captures all the plastic pieces and allows only the nano gold particles coated with DNA to pass through to the plant tissue, which is kept directly below this point. And that is how physically the nanogold particles carrying DNA, target DNA, are injected into the target cells. And a lot of you again would have heard about the CRISPR-Cas9 system, which has become extremely popular for gene editing applications. And this is actually the key component of the CRISPR-Cas system. Basically, this is a region that you engineer to be complementary to the target region on the genome near which you want the editing to take place. And so at this end of the homology piece is where a cleavage happens on the host genomic DNA. And then actually this loop structure is a structure that is necessary for the Cas9 enzyme to come and bind. And once it binds to this region, binds to the complementary site on the human genome, this cleavage happens. And subsequent to this cleavage, the plant's own repair mechanisms again kick in. And the repair can actually lead to either deletion of some bases around here or addition of some random bases around here. And that is not strictly controlled. So each and every editing event can be treated as an event. And you will have to scan through multiple such edited candidates to figure out which one satisfies your requirement. And the CRISPR components can be introduced into the target plant cell either using physical methods like biolistics or using agrobacterium. Moving on to examples of GM crops that are created using one of the earlier methods. I'm just giving you a few examples here. There are a lot more GM crops out there available and being cultivated. So I mentioned actually Flavor Saver tomatoes. They were the first one to be commercially available in the market. And they were meant for delayed ripening of tomatoes. And they basically actually involved silencing of a gene called polygalacturonase in tomatoes, which is required for softening of tomato during the ripening process. By inhibiting the expression of polygalacturonase, the tomatoes actually soften very, very slowly, thereby improving the ability to actually transport these tomatoes over long distances or keep the pulp part of it at a higher level so that it can be used more effectively in processed food items like ketchups. And this was actually quite popular for some time. And then because of various challenges, the company that introduced this technology had, because it's a company called Calgene, which had no experience in agriculture, and they did not know how to market and how to manage the communication, all of that, because of which it got pulled out as a technology, not because of any safety concerns. And golden rice is another example all of you would have heard. I will briefly touch upon this in one of the subsequent slides. And resistance to naturally occurring pests, like I mentioned, the boll rot resistance in BT cotton, which is the only GM crop approved for commercialization in India under the brand name boll rot from Monsanto, which is now Bayer. And then you will see actually the same technology also works for cob borer resistance in maize. And this is actually one of the technologies in which our company Rallis has been working. And we have events which are under regulatory trials as we speak. And the other one, which is a major technology, is resistance to herbicides, which becomes very, very important if we are talking about a mechanized form of agriculture, which happens a lot in Western world, but now we are also beginning to see that in countries like India. So herbicides, basically what they do is they will kill the plants on which they are sprayed. But what we want is we want to kill only the weeds, but not the crop plants, right? So what do? You develop a technology by which the crop is rendered resistant to the herbicide that you will be using while the weeds are not modified. So if you spray the herbicide on a field which is cultivating such a herbicide resistant crop, then once you place the herbicide, spray the herbicide, the crop will be perfectly fine while all the weeds will be killed. And one example of this is Roundup Ready soybeans. Roundup Ready is the brand name given by Monsanto for this technology. So this is just to say, if there is a useful gene available in the biosphere, it can be put to good use in any source that we think of. Here, actually, I've just given the pathway which is involved in the synthesis of beta carotene, which is the precursor for vitamin A. And here you see normal rice, and this is golden rice, and it looks golden primarily because it is accumulating beta carotene. And many key enzymes which are required for beta carotene pathway to go on, starting from this geranyl diphosphate, are absent in rice, which is why the whole pathway is engineered into rice by bringing genes for the corresponding enzymes in the pathway from various sources. So a whole pathway has been engineered into rice, thereby making rice capable of producing the precursor of vitamin A within itself. And this slide talks about the distribution of GM crops globally. Please don't actually try to look at all the details that are given here. This is only to give you an idea that there is a very wide spread globally when it comes to cultivation of GM crops. And if you see India, the only GM crop that is being cultivated is cotton. So that is what is actually shown here. And you will see that this map basically shows countries showing all these different crops in this map. And you will see as of 2018, more than 2.5 billion hectares of GM crops have been planted. And I'll probably skip through this slide, but you can actually take a look at this slide, because the slide deck will be shared with all of you. But quickly, what I would like to say is, in the early evolution of agriculture, if it took thousands of years or centuries for making one significant improvement, now with the development of science, we are actually able to make rapid leaps, either using genomics or marker-assisted breeding methods, or using the genetic modification methods across various crops. So you can see there is a whole range of traits. For example, non-browning mushroom is quite a recent development, only around 2017. This was placed for deregulation in countries like US, and it has been deregulated. Similarly, you will see non-browning apple. What we see is when we cut apple, the cut surfaces of apple start browning after some time due to oxidation. But the newly engineered apples don't brown like that, so there is no oxidation there. And there are potatoes with altered starch. What they actually do is, with unaltered potatoes, the kind of starch that is there leads to production of a chemical called polyacrylamide when potato is deep fried, like in your finger chips of potato, which a lot of people love. But this altered starch composed potato does not actually have that issue. Even if it is deep fried, it does not produce polyacrylamide. And what can polyacrylamide, just acrylamide. And what can acrylamide do? Acrylamide actually in higher concentrations can act as a neurotoxin in human beings. And moving on to the next topic of what exactly are the pressing needs to resort to GM crops. One of the major sources is the need to develop sustainable ways by which we do agriculture. And some of the salient points are listed here. This actually has the ability to increase crop productivity. How is this achieved? Let us say if the productivity of cotton was 1x before BT cotton was introduced into India, suddenly farmers were looking at 5x to 10x productivity simply because the bolls were not damaged by the bollworms. And the bollworms are not just from a single species. There is a collection of, a whole collection of them, three of them being major, right? And for controlling this, the farmers were actually spraying 14, 15 times during the crop period of, let us say, close to 7-8 months. And so on the one side, we were spraying a lot of chemicals. And on the other side, the chemical pesticides are sprayed by farmers based on what is called as economic threshold level of infestation, or ETL. And only after they start seeing the insect damage in the crop, they will spray. By the time they see that, already some damage is done, right? So this is how actually a crop like BT cotton or BT maize can actually increase productivity while reducing the production cost, because you don't have to spray chemicals on those crops. And that actually dovetails into the second point, where it says it is an ecologically friendly footprint driving technology, because it lowers pesticide use in crops that carry Bacillus thuringiensis Cry genes or similar insect control genes for controlling pests. It contributes to alleviation of poverty and hunger. That is basically, again, because better productivity is assured even in marginal farms. That is where actually a balance has to be struck between the cost of the technology and the benefits of the technology. And that is already taken care of, which is why you will see that as much as 98 to 99% of cotton cultivated in India is of the BT cotton category. And conservation of biodiversity, this actually prevents deforestation and things like that, primarily, again, because we are able to produce more without the need for expanding the land footprint. So more as we get into future, more and more of what we will see is we will see reduced water availability per unit area of land, reduced land availability per head of population. Things like that will start increasing with increase in population, because the land area is limited. We cannot suddenly increase the land area, and there is also a need to maintain forest area and green cover to ensure that the effects of climate change are combated. So all of these can be integrated using a combination of GM and non-GM crops and integrated pest management practices and so on. And it reduces actually the use of fossil-based fuels. What this actually means is, if you see many countries in North America and South America where mechanized farming happens, there are huge machines that wade through hectares of farmland for spraying chemicals. Now, when you don't have to actually use those vehicles which run on fossil fuel because the crops have inbuilt resistance for insect pests, then the fossil fuel utilization in the farmland is reduced. And this is just a specific case that is applicable to BT cotton growing areas, where there is data that substantiates that 1.65 crore poor farmers and their families in many countries that are listed here have been benefited. And a lot of them have moved from the status of poor farmers to financially better off farmers who are able to send their children to good education. This is another actually dramatic example, and I suggest that you actually go to the web and do a search for Hawaii and papaya virus disease. You will see a lot of stories, and this story is one of the most dramatic stories you will read as to what a GM crop did to the livelihoods of one large area of the integrated United States of America. So you see, this is the plant that is affected by ring spot virus, and this is how the fruit affected by the virus looks, and its marketability is seriously compromised, and nobody will be interested in buying this kind of virus affected fruits. And I would say close to 80% of the agrarian economy of Hawaii is dependent on papaya. And when it started devastating papaya acres after acres in Hawaii, farmers were clueless as to what to do, and the government was in panic as to how do we overcome this situation. And one of the Hawaii origin scientists who was working at Cornell University, in collaboration with private sector, he actually developed a technology using the coat protein of the ring spot virus of papaya, and developed transgenic papaya, which became completely resistant to ring spot virus. And that completely changed the scenario in Hawaii, and people went back to being normal in terms of their papaya cultivation. And like I actually mentioned a few minutes back, there is increasing demand on productivity because the land area is fixed. Water availability is going to be fixed, or actually it is going to reduce over a period of time. And the arable land, even though the overall land is fixed, the arable land is getting cut down because it is being converted to other purposes. Because of which, actually, if you just see this number, as of 2010, the arable land available per person globally was reduced to 0.2 hectares. This is in 2010, when the population was around 7 billion. Now imagine, by 2050, when the population becomes 9 plus billion, with reduction in arable acres, with reduction in water availability, what will we do? We have to find all ways of improving crop productivity, which means crop productivity cannot be increased by increasing the amount of land or other inputs. It has to be increased per unit area, which is where the use of technology, including GM crops, come into play. I'm saying including because there are also other ways of improving, which is why you need to ask the question, what is the appropriate technology to use for increasing productivity, which is getting challenged by a particular case in a crop. Moving on to concerns. One of the key concerns was impact on non-target organisms. Okay, now if you take something like a chemical pesticide, even though you are spraying the chemical pesticide to control, let us say, the bollworms in cotton, the pesticides are not very selective. They will actually destroy most of the pests on the crop, right? And the GM crops, will they also do something like this? What's the fear? Now, if we are talking about a technology like Bacillus thuringiensis driven insect tolerance, it is very, very important to notice that these proteins have very high specificity. They can actually affect only a small group of insects, and nothing outside of this small group can be affected by these proteins, which is why actually they, I would say, are the perfect solution for a concern like this, which we have no control over when we are using chemical pesticides. And when we move on to the next concern of allergic reactions, some people are afraid that we don't know, something new has been introduced and it can cause allergic reactions. And what has been actually scientifically established, because their fears are on based on two different things. One is a native protein may be modified and reintroduced, or a completely new protein, like in the case of BT, may be introduced into the crop, and either of these could cause allergies. And what has been systematically established is the risk profile of a GM crop based on a technology like BT is equivalent to what is normally seen in conventional crops. In fact, the allergy risk from conventional crops to many people is so high that in comparison to that, the specific allergies that will be created by GM crops will be infinitesimally small. You may have heard that there are some people who are seriously allergic to nuts. There are some people who have allergies to peanuts. So if they eat peanut, they will get very, very severe allergic reactions in their body. And there are people who are very allergic to dairy products. There are people who are very allergic to brinjal, right? So such allergies actually are of greater concern in comparison to the potential for a GM crop to create allergy. And the second aspect is all GM crops undergo safety studies where actually scanning for allergic reactions also is a component. And transfer of genetic material from genetically engineered foods to the cells of the human body is another concern that was actually raised by some people. And here actually we will have to just sit back and think. For instance, for millennia, humankind has been eating a lot of plants. And it is reasonable to say no one has seen a human being who has started doing photosynthesis. I'm sure nobody has seen. And after millennia of consuming the nucleic acids of plant-derived foods and animal-derived foods, if we don't see any of those characters in us, it is very, very hard to conceive that suddenly a genetically engineered crop which just carries maybe 3 kb or 4 kb or 5 kb of DNA containing one or two genes from other species can create something like this. And that is actually just logic, but there is also scientific evidence based on very systematic studies that has discredited that this is not a fear that we need to stick to. Anti-nutritional factors, again, this is something that has been raised. And there are some cases where, especially soybean, which actually intrinsically have the potential for anti-nutrients, and with some of the GM crop events in soybeans, a higher content of anti-nutrients have been observed. But all of those actually get caught when, according to regulation, the technology developer has to establish substantial equivalence. So substantial equivalence basically means you do compositional analysis of the original crop versus the GM crop and show in terms of composition of various constituents, they are comparable. Unless this is established, the crop will not be commercialized. And typically, crops with their own anti-nutrients already known will get a special focus at the hands of regulators when we come to GM crops in those crops. Another concern, which actually is a subset of what we discussed in the earlier slide, is many of the GM crops use a promoter from a plant virus called cauliflower mosaic virus. It's called the cauliflower mosaic virus 35S promoter. And people also were afraid because for selecting transformed cells, antibiotic resistance genes have been used, whether these genes will be transferred to the gut bacteria that we carry, and suddenly they will become resistant to this antibiotic. And if we have to be given an antibiotic for a particular condition, and from due to horizontal transfer from bacteria carrying the resistance gene to other bacteria, the treatment may become ineffective. This is actually very, very far-fetched. And again, this has been demonstrated to be a zero risk. And then there are sociological reasons. One of the reasons cited is, this technology is in the domain of multinational companies and it is very expensive. So it is not affordable to poor farmers, which again has been proven to be a myth, because I showed you what happened with BT cotton and poor farmers in many developing countries in one of the previous slides. And because unless it is kept affordable, farmers will not be even interested in the technology. And reduction in labor requirement will affect rural livelihoods. This is another concern with which I personally have a big problem. We actually are expecting people to continue to do what they have been doing for generations, that is manual labor in agriculture fields. And we say that is necessary. And if a technology comes, they won't have anything else to do, because of which we should not have technology. That actually, in my opinion, is a ridiculous reason to have. And there is a lot of sociological publications covering this particular aspect, which interested people can access from the World Wide Web. And a lot of people also claim that biodiversity is reduced with the introduction of GM crops. And this, again, is completely unsubstantiated, because whether you actually give a new variety of corn or not, unless the farmer is interested in that, the farmer is not going to suddenly drop all the other varieties he or she has been cultivating and jump to cultivating only this. And even if they want the technology will be in diversified germplasm, which is why this erosion of biodiversity is again something that is not at all a fear to have. And moving on to the next part, which is the regulatory framework, I won't go into the details. I just want to convince the people in the audience that there is a very rigorous framework within India that is existing that ensures that the technology is passing through appropriate filters in terms of regulation before it can be commercialized officially. So these are all various bodies, and you can actually refer to these at leisure, because all of this information also is available on the web. And again, just elaborating on the approval process, what I showed in the previous slide is just the framework. But now, as applicants, when Rallis India Limited wants to do field trials with, let us say, BT maize, we have to first take it through what is called as Institutional Biosafety Committee, which is internal to Rallis, but where a government representative also will be sitting. And after IBSC approval, it gets forwarded to Review Committee on Genetic Manipulation, where experts from academia will be reviewing our application and all of the underlying data before giving approval for trials. And with the trials being conducted, what happens is, after a set of trials are conducted, the final trials are conducted and completed, GEAC or Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee evaluates all of the results and then makes a recommendation to the ministry for environmental release. And for whatever reasons, this committee is not feeling safe with the technology. They will basically say this technology is not approved for environmental release. And throughout this process, actually, there are multiple monitoring exercises that happen. And here again, actually, you can see a very long list of scientific studies that have to be carried out by each and every technology developer before a technology can be commercialized. So the most of these actually are based on what is the crop biology and what are the gross changes we are introducing by genetically modifying this plant, and what is the technique we are using, and whether the event that is inserted is stable in the plant across generations. All of these are studied here. And there is a whole section on food and feed safety, because some of the materials may be consumed by human beings and some of that may be consumed by animals, which is why food and feed safety is done. You will see here that there is an elaborate set of animal toxicity studies that have to be done for both acute toxicity as well as subchronic or chronic toxicity. There is an assessment of allergenicity that uses various databases to compare the amino acid sequence of the new protein we are introducing versus known allergens available globally. And then also, if a protein is stable to very high temperatures as well as digestion by the enzymes we normally see during the digestion process in our gut, it is actually tagged as an allergen and will not be approved. Even if it does not have any homology to a known allergen in the database, this single attribute itself will be a rejection criterion. And this is where substantial equivalence comes. I said compositional analysis, where a lot of ingredients will have to be compared between the non-modified and the modified crop. And there is livestock feeding studies where actually milch cows are fed with a GM crop material, and they go on to study whether there is any impact on the health of the milch cow, and there is any change in the composition of the milk, and whether there is any, let us say, BT protein present in the milk. Things like that are systematically studied. And again, from an environmental perspective, suddenly with this GM crop, is some other non-target organism affected, and whether any soil microflora or microfauna, they are impacted adversely, and whether suddenly this GM crop can become a weed. Things like that are systematically studied to ensure that there is no serious impact on the environment. So this covers the crop biology, food and feed safety, as well as environmental safety. That actually brings us to the end of my presentation.
Thank you, sir, for your insights on GM crops, their regulations, benefits, and health hazards. It was indeed a very informative and valuable session. We do have some questions from our participants. Can we go to the questions, sir?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay, sir. The first one, does the World Health Organization play a role in evaluating GM foods?
World Health Organization actually does not have a direct role, because see, every GM crop will have to go through regulations within the country, and WHO is not country specific. So if somebody wants to commercialize a GM crop in the US, they have to go through US Food and Drug Administration, US FDA. And if somebody is interested in commercializing a crop in India, then they have to go through RCGM and GEAC and the corresponding ministry, things like that. So WHO does not have a direct role in the approval of the GM crop.
Okay, sir. Thank you. The next question. So far, how many crops are genetically modified? How many have reached the market?
So I cannot tell you the exact number, but I would say no less than 20-25 have already reached the market. And there is quite a lot actually in the pipeline, which are, see, for example, if you take the example of India itself, I would say nearly 20 different technologies are awaiting regulation. And because of some unnecessary or unwanted, untimely reasons like politics, things have got delayed. Otherwise, we will be actually seeing a lot more.
Okay, sir. The next question. Golden rice is not popular in spite of its benefits. Why? And does golden rice trigger any allergic reactions?
Actually, as we speak, I can tell you, even though BT Brinjal did not have any luck in India, BT Brinjal got commercialized in Bangladesh, and it is now approved for cultivation in Philippines as well. Probably looking at these Asian countries' stands, India also might change. And as we speak, the final stages of golden rice trials in Bangladesh are completed, and it has been approved for commercial cultivation, which basically means it will start being cultivated in Bangladesh. See, golden rice per se is relevant only for Asian countries. And what exactly is the purpose of golden rice? It is to take care of vitamin A deficiency, which is prevalent among the poorer sections of communities in Asia. And since the target is the poorer sections of the communities, it is actually the imperative of the governments to take up something like this to ensure that nutritionally enhanced staple crops are made available to the public. Now, again, because of various political reasons, it is not happening in countries like India. And the second reason is, even if it is introduced in countries like Bangladesh and India, I don't think actually it will become a mainstream staple, because well-to-do people who are able to eat balanced diet would not suddenly want to eat a yellow colored rice because they've been used for so long to eating white colored rice. So these are also personal preferences apart from the regulations.
Okay, sir, thank you. Moving on to the next question from Monisha. Does GM crops influence human genetic mutations?
So this question was already answered by me during the presentation. See, the GM crops, basically, the only way you will come into contact with their DNA is by consuming. And whatever DNA is consumed by us consciously or unknowingly, they haven't been able to become part of our genome in any way. When that is the case, actually, there is no question of any impact on the genetics of human beings because of consumption of GM crops.
Okay, sir. Okay. We'll move on to the next question, sir. Colored cauliflowers are yet to be seen in India. Are there any reasons for this?
No, that's what I'm saying. See, in India, the stand has become such that if it is not a major food crop, then the technology developers are fairly confident that deregulation is a real possibility, which is why a lot of activity has been focused more on cotton and maize. Even though maize is a food crop, it is not actually consumed so much in India. It has primarily become a feed crop, right? So once the safety and all that is demonstrated, people don't mind feeding those to animals, while, I don't know, for whatever reason, which basically leads to the point on scientific communication on GM crops on a more larger scale to the general public comes up. So what I would say is for food crops, unless there is a real positive signal from an existing example like BT Brinjal, people won't attempt to bring such technologies into India, because BT Brinjal was developed in India, right? But yes, has not been approved for commercial cultivation in India. And farmers actually know the value of the technology the moment they experience it. I don't know how many of you are aware of the history behind how BT cotton got introduced in India. While the company that brought the technology to India was struggling to convince the regulator, because the regulators themselves were new to this technology. So they kept on asking new questions. And every time they will ask a question, another season of experiment is required to give them the answer. While this was happening, somebody who was running a seed company quietly got this event through a cotton seed from the US and bred it into varieties that are adapted to cultivation in India and started selling it in Gujarat. It's a company called Navbharat Seeds. And so many thousands of hectares of cotton was cultivated with this before the regulators realized that actually it's a GM cotton. And the company also was saying actually the regulators have to step up and ensure that an unofficial technology should not be made available. And then the regulators had to scramble, do complete analysis of whatever was given and understand what is the regulatory study requirement in other countries like US, Canada, Australia. And then within a matter of months, the official Bolgard technology was deregulated for commercial cultivation in India. So that is the status. So it is the lack of political and regulatory will that is delaying the access to such technologies to Indian farmers.
Okay, thank you, sir. The next question, we have it from Nila Kripa. She's asking how genetically modified plants can be raised. Is it through tissue culture or by seeds?
See, the first step of creating the genetically modified crop goes through tissue culture. Okay. So, for example, you take a particular tissue which is amenable to agrobacterium mediated transformation. You put the gene of interest in a vector, in a binary vector, into agrobacterium, and then actually select the transformed cells in tissue culture, and you regenerate, and then you transfer it to greenhouse and let it grow as a normal plant. And when this plant sets seeds, from then onwards, it's only cultivated or propagated through seeds. It is not that you need to go through this tissue culture round for every cycle. It is only involved in the first cycle of generation of GM crop development.
Okay, sir. We do have few more questions, sir. The next one from Mr. Ramesh. Why blue cotton in India is not famous?
See, it is also actually something to do with the market size. If somebody has to introduce blue cotton in India, whatever is the technology, whether it is a GM crop or a non-GM crop, for that matter, actually, University of Agricultural Sciences, Dharwad, developed khaki-colored cotton decades back, right? And the demand for that from the industry is not great in India. And that, so if there is no demand from buyers, the farmers are not going to grow it, right? Because they cannot grow for the love of growing blue colored cotton. They should have buyers. If they don't have buyers, they will not grow that crop.
Okay, sir. Okay. We have a question from a participant, Prado. Can GM crops act as threat to wild crops?
I actually don't understand that question because in the early part of this talk, I mentioned there are multiple alternatives that are available, right? And if you have a wild crop as a relative of a cultivated crop, and the wild crop has a useful trait that you want to transfer, then there is a set of non-GM technology options that are available for the breeder and the scientist to take. While if there is no such occurrence, only then actually the scientists go to look for such a gene in a different species which is not sexually compatible with the crop you are interested in. I actually don't see a scenario where a wild species is threatened because of introduction of GM crops.
Okay.
I don't see a scenario like that at all.
Okay, sir. Thank you. The next question, which country is the pioneer in cultivating GM vegetables and fruits?
Like I said, actually, North America has been the first country to see a GM tomato, the flavor saver, and then the ring spot virus resistant papaya in Hawaii. So I would say North America is the leader in such technologies, not just in vegetables and fruits, but across field crops as well, like maize, cotton, soybean. All of these technologies were, because the technology developer, the original technology developer, major technology developer, was located in the United States.
Okay, sir. Okay. The next question, do GM foods influence immunity levels?
I can't see a correlation at all.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you. There's a question from a participant, Mr. Balaji. Will GM crops interfere in nature's quality and disturb human health?
Actually, I would again go back several slides and say how judicious deployment of a combination of technologies can lead to more sustainable agriculture, which also means greener earth. So I don't actually see GM crops as a factor that would threaten. I would actually say GM crops can accomplish exactly the opposite.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Keeping the time in mind, we'll just take a few more questions, sir, just a couple of them.
Sure.
Okay, sir. What are the dangers for the scientists working on genetically engineered plants?
Zero. Because I myself have directly worked, and and I have actually a lot of friends who have been working for decades on developing GM crops. There is zero risk because, see, actually students can do very simple experiments. If you have access to a culture of, let us say, something like E. coli, you take that and try to put even a plasmid DNA just into that culture and see whether it is capable of entering into the bacterial cell. Even if you put tons of plasmid DNA into that, you will be surprised to see that no single bacterium has been able to take it up. That is because very specific conditions have to be brought into picture even for a bacterial cell to accept outside DNA. And such conditions can be created specifically only inside test tubes.
Okay, sir. The next question, what further developments can be expected in the area of genetically engineered crops?
See, one of the things that the technology evolution has seen is initially GM crops focused on traits that are visible to the farmers and the people at large. For example, if you take a BT cotton or BT maize, if you plant a non-BT maize and a BT maize next to each other, and you don't spray anything on either of these fields, you will see a dramatic difference. Similarly, if you take a non-herbicide tolerant crop and a herbicide tolerant crop and come and spray herbicide, you will see that the non-herbicide tolerant crop is completely decimated by the spray, while the tolerant crop is healthy, while all the weeds are gone. So if you have to remove all the weeds from the other non-herbicide tolerant crop, you will have to resort to manual or mechanical methods of removing weeds, which is very, very expensive and time consuming. So it is very, very important to keep such factors in mind when you are introducing a new technology, which is why visible technologies were the first generation technologies introduced. Now, what is also beginning to happen is the world has experienced the difficulties at the hands of regulators and the general public when it comes to GM crops. And different countries are regulating gene-edited crops differently, right? Because the justification is in gene-edited crops, you are not introducing any foreign DNA. It is like actually mutagenesis. So breeders for eons have used irradiation as well as, let us say, mutagenic agents like ethane methyl sulfonate, EMS, for mutating crops, for developing them or improving them, right? So the countries like US and Australia and Japan, they have decided that gene-edited crops, once it is very clearly demonstrated they don't carry any extraneous DNA and are equivalent to the original crop, they will not be regulated at all by the government, right? But the regulation in India is still evolving. There are only discussions going on and we don't know as to how it will go. Because of this, and also the fact that it is going to be a lot cheaper to develop gene-edited crops, there is a sudden spurt in the emergence of gene-edited crops. For example, a small company, not the multinational companies, a small company in the US was the first to introduce a gene-edited crop, which is an oilseed crop like canola, which is a relative of mustard. And that crop actually has improved nutritional value in terms of having more hot, healthy lipid composition. It has the right mix of unsaturated versus saturated fatty acids. Things like that, which are focusing on nutrition but using cheaper technology and which are either minimally regulated or not regulated, or taking or picking up pace. So that is what you will see, and that is also actually another good thing, because then the technology developers won't be focusing only on visible traits. They can focus on any trait that can also bring benefit to the end consumer. Like, for example, high lycopene content tomato. Lycopenes are actually very effective antioxidants. So just like vitamin C, high lycopene tomatoes can actually improve human health. So things like that will start happening. They are already happening in the labs, and more will come to the market in the next few years. And the timelines for developing gene-edited crops are also much, much shorter. Because of the regulatory system, development of a GM crop takes close to 10 years, while gene-edited crops can hit the market in less than 3 years.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. Due to time constraint, we will take up just one last question, sir, from our participant, Shruti. She's asking, do GM crops have an effect on the environment over long run, such as soil around it and its fertility?
So this is actually part of what is conducted as a biosafety study during the regulatory phase of the GM crop development. Certainly, we look at the impact on soil in the fields that are holding GM crop plots. And we try to compare those with the soil composition of non-GM crop plots which are planted as controls in the same trial. And such comparisons are done very, very carefully at the hands of public sector scientists, even if a private sector company is the technology developer, right? And in fact, I can cite at least one example where improvement of soil health is achieved through GM crop is herbicide tolerant crops, where people have shown that with the zero tilling, crops can be cultivated. That improves productivity because the soil structure builds over a period of time and increases the health of the root system of the crop being cultivated. And for such a thing, definitely a weed control technology is necessary. I'm not saying GM is the only way to achieve it, but any which way you achieve a herbicide tolerance trait, then it becomes actually a very good thing for building soil health over a period of time.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir, for sharing this wonderful session with us today. We really appreciate the time you have taken for us and for answering all the questions so patiently. Thank you so much once again, sir.
Thanks a lot. I really enjoyed interacting with the team, even though I was not directly interacting. The questions are clearly indicative of the interest the participants have on this topic. And I'm glad I could be of some assistance in terms of bringing up some level of learning on this important topic.
Thank you, sir. We're really happy. Thank you, sir. I would like to now hand over the session to Dr. Lakshmi Priya, Assistant Professor, Department of Microbiology, to present the report and vote of thanks.
Good evening and my warm greetings to everyone. Industry expert talks provide a lot of inspiration and first-hand industry knowledge. Learning from the experience of the experts gives us a clear vision, new ideas to shape and expand our dreams. Academic world is creative and the industry has the task of commercializing ideas. A productive interface between industry and academia in the present time of knowledge economy is a critical requirement as it brings to meet the industry needs and expectations and academic aspirations. With this in mind, the Departments of Microbiology and Biochemistry has organized this national webinar by industry experts on 13th, 12th and 13th of June 2020. The first day session was presided by Dr. Venkata Subbulakshmi, Founder and Managing Director, Dathi Healthcare and Technologies, Bangalore. She spoke on the boundless opportunities for life science graduates. She highlighted that recent scientific advancement had led to the brilliant growth in pharma and biotechnology industry. Her talk covered the areas of molecular farming, nanotechnology, cell and gene therapy, stem cell research, application of microRNA in cancer therapeutics, and genotyping technologies. Day two of the webinar witnessed a mind-blowing talk by Dr. Ramanathan Vairamani, Chief Technology and Innovation, Rallis India Limited. He elaborated on the effects of genetically modified crops on health. It was amazing to know about the evolution of crops. He validated on the use of GM crops for sustainable agriculture and to increase productivity even under various biotic and abiotic stress conditions. He also explained about the regulatory approval process for the environmental release of genetically engineering plants. Thank you, speakers, for your valuable time and enlightening us on the industry expectation for a dynamically successful career for students who are passionate about science. Thank you once again. Thankfulness is the beginning of gratitude. I would like to place my gratitude to our correspondent, Dr. Lata Rajendran, and our chairman, Mr. Kumar Rajendran, for their support and encouragement in all our endeavors. We are fortunate to be assisted by our principal, Dr. Mani Meghalai, vice principal, Dr. Lakshmi Balaji, dean academics, Dr. Shanti Lakshmi, and dean students, Dr. Abita Sapapati. Thank you, ma'am, for all your guidance. My heartfelt thanks to Dr. Latika, Head Department of BBA and HRM, for connecting us with the resource person. My thanks are due to the dedicated faculty team of Microbiology and Biochemistry Department for their meticulous planning in the execution of this webinar. A special accolade to the technical support team, Dr. Nitya Kalyani, Ms. Mahalakshmi, and Ms. Preeta. Finally, to all the participants out there, a big thank you for your active and enthusiastic participation. The unprecedented lockdown due to the pandemic COVID-19 has crippled our routine life, but there's no lockdown for updating and sharing our knowledge. Take this time to hone your talents and skills. No sun outlasts its sunset, but will rise again and bring the dawn. So stay strong, stay positive, and stay safe. Thank you all.
Thank you, everybody.